a man that is 147 years old. 147 years old. And he's still gardening.
Where does he live? Where does he live?
She wants to go and meet him.
Probably, I'm not sure, but probably Japan. They're the oldest people in the world in Japan.
Amazing.
Which is very interesting. He's out there gardening. Pulling weeds in.
We don't do gardening
we
now.
We don't do that now, no. But he said, the secret is patience. Mm-hmm. You know, with patience comes peace and calm, doesn't it? Yeah. That's what he put it down to. They proved it. They had a certificate when he was born, 1870, I think.
Something like that.
So that was probably a bit old, that one. He's probably 2 years older now. He's not. I was 20. Went out and bought his plot. He said, it's time for me to go. So went out and bought his plot. So, yeah, interesting, isn't it? Life is very interesting. Anyway, what I want to talk about this morning is intimacy with God. Now, please don't take this as good works. Because intimacy with God is not good works, it's good sense. A big difference.
Yeah.
Because if you learn to listen and hear from God, your life will flow a lot easier. Mm. It was interesting too, many years ago, we had a visiting speaker from Russia. And the persecution at that time was really on against Christians. Every time they got a building, they would double, treble, and keep on putting the rents up and up till they couldn't afford it, or they'd make excuses at the last minute that you couldn't use the venue. And so what they had to do was to say to people, okay, you know we're going to be somewhere next Sunday. You have to ask God where we are. Because as soon as they put it on text or anything like that, everyone knows, and those people that are assigned to watch them and look over them, the communists, you know, they're in everything, there's always implants there, they will be in it. So they were always trying to be one ahead of them. And people would turn up because they heard from God where to go. Isn't that awesome?
Yeah, amazing.
You know, things like that. That intimacy with God is so important. When Sue and I first got married, I hadn't been married very long, and I had to go international service, which is the army. In those days, if your birthday fell on a certain date, then you had the honour of going, and for 14 weeks of army training down in Waiuru. And then for the next 3 years, you had two to three weeks, depending how they worked it, of having to, once again, go to either Nauru or here, or those sort of places. Anyway. So, not long after we married, I got called up to the wonderful army. And looking back now, it really didn't do me that much, do any harm. It certainly made me get up earlier. And that's never changed, you know? It's never changed. As far as going for a run every morning, that changed. But other certain things. But it was a time of where we just didn't like being with each other. We just wanted to be with each other. And every time the mail came, I'd have a lovely stack of letters, which the others would be very envious of. Look what wife he sent, all these letters, you know. And I'd be sending as much as I could. It couldn't always because we had all these maneuvers and things like that. But it was a time of the love for each other was so powerful, so strong. But as time went on, of course, the trials and tribulations of life. You have, first of all, children come along, and they can put a tremendous strain, as you know, on relationships. I see we've all got saints here, no one said amen. They can put pressure on relationships. And then there's, of course, there's finances when you start getting a mortgage and all that sort of thing. And so the focuses of both become too much more around themselves than each other. It's not a deliberate thing, it's something that just happens. And the same things happen in the things of God. Many people, when they first get saved, it's that they're so excited, they can feel the presence of God, they can walk and talk with God, and they pray and things happen. And then over a period of time, it seems to wane a little bit, and you think, this doesn't seem to be working. This has become more of a work, as it were, to make things work. But keeping that intimacy with God, walking and talking with Him, those opportunities that you get. When you're driving in the car, there's so much time wasted. You can be walking, driving and talking to God. You can pray in tongues in the car. Mm. That's what's so good about tongues. Mm. You can do it anywhere, anytime.
Yeah, that's right.
And it never ends. It only ends when you stop. And that's when you're building intimacy all the time. So please don't take this as works, it isn't.
No, that's right.
It's good sense to be or improve that relationship with God so that you know that when you pray, He hears you. He doesn't always answer yes to your prayers. They've got to be correct prayers for a start, but He will never, ever let you down in the long term. God is never in a hurry. I've told Him about that several times. And He's not always what I consider on time. I'll have words with Him about that too, as we all do. But knowing that you know how much He loves you and how much that intimacy can grow because of how much He loves you. See, it's not how good you are, it's how good God is.
Amen.
And, and that's the part, if we focus on how good He is, then the other part becomes easy. See, in the Old Testament it says you are commanded to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your mind, with all your whole being. You can't.
No.
You're human.
Yeah, that's right.
You're going to be selfish somewhere.
That's right.
No amens again, okay?
Yeah, I agree.
That's my halo slip.
Yes, sir.
So it's a matter of being honest with God. He knows everything about you.
That's right.
Don't be a person that, oh, He's only just found out when I confess or whatever. He knows everything about you.
That's right.
He knows more about you than you do.
That's right.
Ooh, that's different, isn't it? So Proverbs 3, verse 6. Become intimate. Become intimate. So it means that we can become more intimate with the living God.
Yes.
It's telling us there, become means work. Work, not good works, as I'm saying, but it's for our benefit. I mean, obviously it's our benefit that husband and wife, we get on well. It's obvious that we spend time together. It's obvious too that, and in the last few years, it's been really interesting. It's almost like we're right back to our first love. You know, we're closer now than we've ever been.
Amen.
And it's so intriguing. We're driving along the road, and one of us will think something, and the other one will speak it. And it's happened so many times.
Praise God.
And I'm still working on it, so I can think something and go, do, do, do. Make rules to be. But it's only like, oh, I really fancy a pie. Oh, I was thinking that too. You know? Yeah, you can. Become intimate with Him in whatever you do, and He will lead you wherever you go. He will lead you wherever you go.
Yes, that's right.
Knowing and having that peace. I love this bit. Don't think for a moment that you know it all. Would you like me to repeat that? Don't think for a moment that you know it all. You don't know it all.
That's right.
You're human.
Right.
In fact, it's mind-boggling when you start to think how big God is.
That's right.
You just look around the city, all the people's lives, all interwoven, driving around, doing this, that, and the other. And then you multiply it over this whole nation, then you multiply that over the world, and God still can speak to you individually. Mm. It's like, tilt, tilt, this is really cool.
Amen.
You'll never know it all.
No, that's right.
Not even once. You'll never know it all. In fact, somebody said to me one day, they said, The Lord knows, does know it all. He knows everything. Now, we don't, or we can't see into the future like we'd like to. It's like when you're driving along and there's a hill in front of you. You can't see over that hill or what's going on the other side. But if you went from the car to the helicopter, you could see even further. That's in everything in life, isn't it? He can see further than you. You can't see that far. He knows everything. He knows what's going to happen with the job that you're working. He knows all those things. And so sometimes, you know, we don't give that enough to him and say, okay, God, you know my future more than I do. I'm just going to trust in you that things will start to unfold in the direction you want me to go. And we can rest in that then. For wisdom comes when you adore him. Wisdom is available to us. It says, ask for wisdom. It is a great thing. Solomon got blessed because he asked for wisdom. He did not ask for riches. He did not ask for all those things. They came with wisdom. So when you ask for wisdom, wisdom is a treasure thing. Because it will show you how to make money. It will show you how to deal with people. It will show you, there's some crankies going on, and it will show you how to diffuse it. It will show you all those things, the wisdom of God. It's once said, a person is wise who keeps their mouth shut more often. And that's true, isn't it? Well, I think it's true.
Yes.
From my own experience, I can say it is true. There's nothing worse. I mean, I'm talking about the early days of Sue would say something and I would have the answer. And before, or as it was coming out, you realize, no, it's too late. It's gone. And it's had the undesired effect. But later in life, I asked the Lord to give me a little bit of leeway, as it were, a longer fuse, or like wisdom. You know, like wisdom. That's where wisdom is good sometimes. Because women, sometimes, man, this is a good lesson for some of you. wisdom comes in the form that men are made different to women, in that sometimes the women will come to the husband or to a friend or somebody and you say something and you think, I've got the answer. I've got all the answers you need, and you just want to rip it with all your answers. But sometimes wisdom is, shut up. And then she will ask the question, go through what she thinks it should be, and give you the answer, and she'll say, thank you very much. That's happened. Not to you, well, it's happened to me. It's, well, thank you for listening, darling. That was really good. I think, well, I didn't really say anything. I just listened, you know, but I had so much in me that I wanted to impart. I know the answer to that. Then you will find healing refreshment, your body and spirit long for. Glorify God with all your wealth, honoring him with your very best, with every increase that comes to you. See, if you trust God, you have no problem giving. If you don't trust God, you will always struggle with giving.
That's right.
You will always see giving as a loss rather than a gain. Mm. I don't say that you get into your mind, well, you know, every little bit you give, you're trying to work out how much God's going to give back to you. And I know one guy used to keep a book, used to keep a tally. I gave this to God, I want to see my sevenfold return, I said, and he'd keep a tally of it. But that's not how to do it. That's not intimacy.
Intimacy is
when God tells you, you're just able to give.
Amen.
You haven't got a problem giving because you know God won't let you go without. It will come one way or another. It does. I mean, I've been doing this, been around this long enough to know that God never, you can't outgive God.
Right.
Sometimes it feels like you have, Sometimes it feels like, when's it ever going to happen? But it will. It will, it has to.
That's right.
That every dimension of your life will overflow with blessings from an uncontrollable source of inner joy.
Uncontainable.
Same thing.
No.
Who wants uncontrollable?
No.
Who wants uncontrollable?
Me.
See, like I've said before, I've got the Holy Ghost in soon. And every dimension of your life will overflow with blessings from an uncontainable source of joy.
Thank you, Pastor.
Source of joy. Where's your joy? Intimacy with God, knowing that He loves you.
Amen. That's right. Praise God.
Amen.
Amen. Amen, Pastor. That's right.
Always put God before people. Don't let people control you. Ask God. Don't let money control you. You'll be miserable if all you do is chase money. Put God first, and these things will happen. Once again, I'm not just giving it out of scriptures and so forth. I'm giving it out of actual experience. You put God first, and He will bless you
Amen.
Abundantly.
Yes.
That's not good works, is it?
No.
As I say, it's good sense.
Good.
Once you can get to that point of trusting God, then your life does have a different dimension of joy.
Yes.
Because you're not going to be stressed. Mm. You know, hey, God says, give and it shall be given unto you. Pressed down, shaken together with the same measure.
Yes.
Oh, I thought that was good.
Yes, it was.
Thank you, Lord. That was good. Matthew 6, 33. So above all, constantly chase after the realm of God's kingdom and the righteousness that proceeds from Him. Then all these less important things will be given to you abundantly. When you say chasing after God's kingdom, it means having the opportunity to soak on His word, to get that word into you, which makes you stronger. Stronger, you know, it's like, a lot of people believe in the Christian world that you won't inherit the kingdom of God if you sin. But you've already, the kingdom of God is already there. But what intimacy brings is that connection with it to make it work in your life. But it's not good works because it's still a benefit to you as such, but it's just building in your mind, in your heart, in your spirit that God loves you that much that He won't let you down.
That's right.
That's it. Sometimes in life it feels that He has. But sometimes He's steering you, building that character in you. But He won't let you suffer any longer within those things forever. You know what I mean? There's going to be a major breakthrough because you stood your ground and said, I trust God regardless of what.
Amen.
Regardless. Refuse to worry about tomorrow. How often do we worry about tomorrow? Isn't today enough? Isn't it enough today? Why worry about tomorrow?
Yeah.
You say, oh, well, Pastor, you don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. I don't. I don't want to. I've got enough today.
Yeah.
And this is what this guy was saying, you know, 147. It's patience. Patience and just knowing that things will sort themselves out. To be honest, how many times have you worried about something and it never happened? How many times have you, what's the best word, surmised in a particular situation, you've already worked out what you think is the problem, and when you get there and you start to talk about it, it's nothing like you thought. Good example, an instant example, is the phone rings. What are your thoughts? Oh, somebody's ringing to give me $1 million. I doubt it. Particularly if it's late at night. What do you think? What is your first reaction? That shows what your major programming is.
That's right.
You have to laugh then. The phone rings. Oh, I wonder who that is. Why don't you answer it and you'll find out. We say such weird things, don't we? Wonder who that is. Refuse to worry about tomorrow. But deal with each challenge that comes your way, one day at a time. Tomorrow will take care of itself.
Amen.
And it does, you know. It does. Sometimes we get so wound up, and then it's almost like we're wound up like a spinning top, you know. And then next day, let it go, and we realise that what we got so wound up about was so pathetic, so non-event. All right, it's happened to me. If it doesn't happen to you, that's all right.
It's all you.
2 Corinthians 11:3. But now I'm afraid that just as Eve was deceived by the serpent's clever lies, your thoughts, this is the part of mania, your thoughts may be corrupted, and you may lose your single-hearted devotion and pure love for Christ.
Wow.
What?
That's good.
See what I'm trying to show you here? How easy we're deceived by the demonic realm.
Yeah.
They whisper things. Mm-hmm. He whispers things. He tells lies. He sets you up. Don't listen to them. And the more you have intimacy with God, the less those things can have influence on you. Hello, did you hear that one? That was profound. That was very profound. The more you hear from God and have the intimacy with Him, the less the devil can lie to you
yes.
and get away with it.
Amen.
That's why spend time with God.
Yes.
Don't say you have time. We have more time now than we've ever had in the history of mankind.
Yes, that's true.
You know that? It's what we choose. What we choose. I haven't got time. I'm spending too much time watching TV. Well, guess what? It's got an off button. It amuses me when people say, oh, such and such a program is so disgusting, people shouldn't be watching it. How do you know it's disgusting? Why didn't you just turn it off? You don't have to watch it. Don't waste your time about censoring. You've got your censor. Get it together.
Yeah, that's right.
You got to read it. Verse 6. But whenever you pray, go into your innermost chamber and be alone with the Father. This is the intimate time. Walking and talking with God without anyone else around. Just laying everything that's in your heart. You're not going to upset God because He knows what you think anyway. Just pour it out. Say, God, I feel you've let me down. God, I feel these things aren't going right. Show me how. Show me how to get back my joy. And you get a scripture pop up, some quote of it. The joy of the Lord is my strength. So have a joyful time.
That's right.
And your Father who sees you do, all you do, will reward you openly. When you pray, there is no need to repeat empty phrases. You do that? Say it over and over again, like God didn't hear you the first time. Who are you trying to convince? I'll let that one sink in. It's not how long you pray, it's how well you pray. Praying like those who don't know God. When you pray, there is no need to repeat empty phrases. Praying like those who don't know God. When we say don't know God, they don't really know how good God is. For they expect God to hear them because of their many words. In the past, we've had people, they really want you to pray over them lots and lots and lots and lots of words. They think, well, if you pray lots and lots and lots of words, something's going to happen. But sometimes a simple prayer, in the name of Jesus be healed, is simple enough. Not, oh Lord, you know how good they are. The other day they witnessed to so-and-so. Oh God, you know, what a loving person she is. You don't have to convince God. You're saved. You're born again. You're a child of the Most High God. You can't let good works try to talk God. Because I've done this, then you should do that. That's works. And that's works at the worst level. Because you're making mockery of God, of what He has given you for free. Man, that was good too.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord. Verse 8, and there's no need to imitate them, since your Father already knows what you need before you ask Him. Pray like this, Our Father, this is Old Testament, I know, in heavenly realms, may the glory of your name be the center on which our lives turn. Now, interesting. Our Father, not our provider, not our healer, our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. What he's trying to do is get us focused on the Father, not what you need. Many of us only go to God or only go to prayer when we have a need or we have needs for others. But spending time just loving Him and saying how much you love Him, it's like a little child. A little child walks in saying, Mummy, I really love you. Mummy says, okay, how much do you want? Or what do you want? Oh no, I don't want anything. I just wanted to say how much I love you. Doesn't that change something on the inside?
Yeah.
That love came out of not trying to persuade you to give me some more out of your wallet. But it come out of, I just love you for who you are and what you are. And that's how Jesus
Amen.
Is. Pray like this, Our Father, not our provider, not our healer. It's our Father, which is far greater. You agree?
Amen.
You can make a little bit of noise, it's quiet.
Yeah. Amen, Pastor.
It's quite frightening up here sometimes. It's not, everyone's quiet. They're looking at you. The ones who are not asleep are looking at you. 2 Corinthians 5:13. As if we are out of our minds in a blissful divine ecstasy. I've got it.
Yeah.
it is for God. But if we are in our right minds, it is for our benefit. Who wants to be in their right mind?
Yeah.
Yes. Then it's for your benefit. For it is Christ's love that fuels our passion and motivates us. Because we are absolutely convinced, what does absolutely mean? Absolutely.
Absolutely.
Convinced that he has given his life for us, for all of us. This means all died with him. But we don't have to do the physical death.
Right.
He's done it for us. So that those who live should no longer live self-absorbed lives, but lives that are poured out for him, the one who died for us and now lives again. Isn't that awesome?
Yes.
I hope you got a lot out of that this morning.
Amen, Pastor. Very good.
Because God is good.
All the time.
This morning, I was sort of, shall I get up and preach or not? Because I've been coughing so much. And I thought,
you're healed.
The devil doesn't have that right to stop.
Amen.
That's right.
So even though I wasn't feeling too good there, by the time I come up those stairs, I haven't coughed once, have I?
No, you haven't. Yay, thank you.
So God is good.
All the time.
Got a bit croaky. There's somebody said, your voice is very sexy now.
Who is that? Come on.
Yeah. Who said that?
Who is that?
On that note, let's all stand.
Have some respect in the house of God.
It was outside. It's all right. Father, we just thank you for this morning. Lord, it is our desire to become more intimate. Intimacy in hearing your voice, walking and talking with you every opportunity.
Thank you.
As we give you the glory, the honor, and the praise. Everyone said,
Amen. Amen.